Welcome. My name is Catherine Gervis. I have the honor to chair the Columbus Green Team, and I'm also the executive director of Yay Bikes, and I will be your MC this morning. So, welcome to the 9th annual Green Spot Awards. Yay, us, yes. Sustainability threads throughout our community, from households to businesses to churches to nonprofit. Sustainability is really key in all of our organizations and our government organizations. In the city of Columbus, various departments have taken incredible leaps on this. We're here together today to celebrate the success of the businesses and organizations who are taking green seriously and moving those initiatives forward, and to recognize our own success as individuals. So this is going to be an exciting morning. A special thank you to those of you who brought books to donate to Columbus City Schools. Educating our young people about the environment is really key to keeping these initiatives moving forward. And science and critical thinking is just incredibly important for a positive future. Today would not be possible without the support of our sponsors. And I would like to invite our sponsors up to say a few words. You're going to hear from Kyle O'Keefe, who's the Director of Innovation and Programs at the Solid Waste Authority of Central Ohio, otherwise known as SWACO. Come on up, Kyle. From Sherry Hubbard, the Research and Development Coordinator at American Electric Power Ohio, AEP. And Melissa Thompson, Director of Regulatory Policy at Columbia Gas of Ohio.
Kyle O'Keefe with SWACO. Really just wanted to come here and say congratulations to all the awardees and to all the Green Spot members. Today, it's no easy feat actually being a leader in socially and environmentally responsible issues. And we have to sing praise every time we can to those. I know we're here and we are happy to be a collaborator, a supporter of all these initiatives, and really want to continue to take the community forward. So thank you very much.
I am not Sherry Hubbard from AEP Ohio. My name is Mike Lascola. I work with Sherry. She's on vacation this week. I would like to just reiterate what he said. Congratulations. Everybody that I've met and been associated with as a part of the Green Spot program has been fantastic. What you do supports what we do and what Columbia Gas does. I mean, we're out to try to help our customers and consumers learn about energy efficiency, first of all, the education. And participating in our programs gets you there, gets you the help that you need. Customers, whether they're residential or commercial, industrial, help them see, you know, what they can do with energy efficiency to help their systems, their processes, their facilities become more efficient. So we're glad to be a part of that. We're glad to partner with Green Spot. We're working with the Southside Area Commission right now to do some community energy work, again, partnering with Columbia Gas on that. David Celebrese has been fantastic to work with through the years. Every year we participate in anything we can that's Green Spot related. So thank you for having us here. Thank you for all your efforts. Your work helps us and vice versa, so I'm glad to be a part of it. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Melissa Thompson, and I'm with Columbia Gas of Ohio. We're excited to partner with the Green Spot here in the city of Columbus to recognize Columbus's energy efficiency achievements for 2016. Green Spot's community is growing daily with more than 15,000 members, including households, businesses, community organizations, and community groups. We're proud to be a contributing member to Green Spot's energy efficiency efforts because truly, saving energy matters. Every step that we and our customers take, including those of AEP as well, help save energy to help us reduce the impact of our climate. At Columbia Gas Ohio, we are committed to delivering award-winning, best practice energy efficiency programs. By partnering with Green Spot and serving on the Energy Working Group for the City of Columbus's Green Memo 3 initiative, we will reduce energy consumption by 20% by 2020. If you'd like to learn more about Columbia Gas Ohio's programs, as well as our collaborative efforts with AEP, feel free to stop by one of our booths, and our team members will help you take action for a cleaner, healthier, more sustainable Columbus. Congratulations to this year's winners, and we look forward to partnering with Columbus to make the city much more energy efficient. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you for your support and your sponsorship of these initiatives and these great organizations. I now have the honor to welcome to the stage Allison Thompson from the Columbus Metropolitan Library. Is this a great place to hold an event like this? I know, right? Being sustainable is a progression, and what a great example the Columbus Metropolitan Library is. They have made great strides in sustainability over the years. It is something that is at the core of the beliefs of this organization. Now to talk in much greater detail about the green success is Allison Circle, the Chief Customer Experience Officer.
Everyone, it's so lovely to have you all here. Just as a clarity, she introduced me with two different names, and I'm Allison Circle, like the shape circle, so not Thompson, but Circle. So welcome you all to Main Library. We have not yet been open here in this space for a year, and yesterday in this very spot we had over 500 children. It was packed to the gills, jumping up and down, singing to Jim Gill, who was in the corner here, so it was really great. We are also a former Green Spot Award winner here at the library, and as I talk a little bit about some of our efforts here, what is more sustainable than a library, right? I got a couple of props for you. So this morning, my day was made because finally my book came in, and all of our books, as you know, get used amongst everyone, so what a better model of recyclability than that. I, at one point, calculated how much money I have saved by using the library instead of buying all the books that I read anyway, so it's also cost efficient. The other things that we have done as we have been building 10 buildings in the last few years have really focused on sustainability as one of our guiding principles. Some of the things we have done, we've been very careful around stormwater management and rainwater runoff. All of our new buildings have rain gardens in order to mitigate that feature. We are also very thoughtful about the furniture. I have another prop for you. These chairs, which are in all of our new buildings, they're all in our children's area. They're made out of recycled Coke cans. So they're cute and light and fun. The materials that we have, we've used sustainably resourced products in our buildings. We have been very cautious about landscaping and planting with native species, with low water maintenance, try to mitigate mowing of grass, that kind of thing. We've been very thoughtful through water efficiency and plumbing and low limited use of that. Indoor quality, we've paid a lot of attention to that. Energy efficiency, we do a lot of light harvesting. I was just at our Northside branch, which opens in June, and it's awesome. Each new building is my favorite building, but right now that's my favorite. And all of that light is harvested during the day, so we're very careful about that. And for those of you who are worried about the plastic plates, we do have single stream recycling here at the library as well, and all of that is recycled as well. So we are really mindful about our role in this community. We take great pride in the stewardship that we are responsible for, and that really starts with creating a healthy community. Our vision statement is a thriving community where wisdom prevails, and starting with sustainable communities is kind of top of mind around a wisdom and a thriving community. So we are very proud to be here and proud to have a significant role in this community, and I'm proud to stand up here and welcome you all and congratulate the award winners today as well. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Elizabeth Brown, Councilwoman Brown. She was elected in November of 2015 as the first term on Columbus City Council and began January 1st, 2016. Councilmember Brown is the chair of several committees, including economic development, environment, education, and administration. As chair of the Environment Committee, Councilwoman Brown shepherds legislation from the city's residential recycling and yard waste program, as well as other environmental stewardship programs such as Branch Out Columbus, Green Spot, and the Green Columbus Green Columbus Fund. She has also spearheaded resolutions demonstrating support for renewable and energy efficiency initiatives. Please welcome Columbus City Council Member Elizabeth Brown.
All right.
Change in plans.
And here comes Councilmember Brown. Thank you so much. Should we give you a minute to catch your breath and go to the Green Spot video? Okay. We're going to watch a Green Spot video about the awards and then welcome City Councilmember Elizabeth Brown up to the stage.
Hello, I'm Mayor Andy Ginther, and I'm here to let you know about our Columbus Green Spotlight Awards. These awards highlight exceptional successes of small, medium, and large businesses over the course of a year in the areas of conserving and protecting water, conserving energy, reducing, reusing, recycling, and informing and engaging staff and clients, and greener transportation. They receive an award that is made out of recycled glass and etched right here in Columbus. Succeeding in sustainability takes all of us, and we are proud to partner with businesses for continued success. Consider joining GreenSpot, and maybe you'll receive an award next year.
Winning the Green Spotlight Award was really important for the zoo. And for me personally, I honestly set a goal years ago that we had to win that award some year.
Being a Green Spot Award winner is important to us. There are literally hundreds of companies now throughout the city that are Green Spot Award winners.
Even though it's not necessary to run a successful business, it is necessary to do these things so we can create a better place for us.
It's encouraged us to continue forward because it was just cool to see that people care about that.
And the fact that it is so much of our DNA and what we're doing here, like I thought it was a great way to continue to learn more and to become part of a community.
When we initially opened up these doors, we installed a ton of LED lighting.
We have recycled or repurposed a World War II era airplane that we have in Heart of Africa. We've repurposed an 1890s one-room brick schoolhouse, also in the Heart of Africa.
We have always cut our own business cards out and stamped them ourselves.
None of our chairs match, our tables don't match, our silverware and plates don't match. There's a lot that is beautiful and already exists and that we've made work in our space.
Partnered with Habitat for Humanity, so if we're demoing out somebody's kitchen cabinets, countertops, sink, anything that we can donate to them and the homeowner uses that as a tax write-off, it's kind of a win-win situation.
We're big advocates of, you know, the whole farm-to-table movement. It's sort of the backbone of our company here at A&R. We use all the bones, we reduce them down, make them into our stock.
I really wanted the zoo to become a green spot, not only because it was a good thing for our staff so that we could all work together towards common goals and improving our environmental footprint, but also we get over 2 million guests who come through our gates. And I really felt that by our being a green spot and sharing that story, it could create a lot more awareness within our community. And even people who visit here from further away could learn that we're trying to be really good stewards for the environment, but the green spot gives you a great guideline so that you could do it at home or at your business, wherever you might be.
Everybody, I was like 60 seconds from nobody knowing that I was late. Walked in at the exact wrong time. So thank you so much. I do want to thank Allison and the library for all the amazing work and for hosting our celebration today. This is just every time I walk in here, I am kind of overcome with gratitude for the fact that we have this resource in our community. What the library provides to in all of our neighborhoods. This is obviously our sort of our jewel location for the library, but all of our neighborhoods have such incredible libraries that help our residents, everyday residents, have access to learning and community, and I'm incredibly grateful. So thank you, Allison. And as you heard, the library has achieved great success over the years in leading by example when it comes to being a green organization. So they are of many talents, right? I also want to thank the sponsors of these awards and Columbus City Schools. The books donated today will go to elementary schools and will help children learn about the environment through reading. Once again, I'm Elizabeth Brown. I'm chair of the Environment Committee on Columbus City Council, which I feel very lucky to do because we have an incredible community in this city that's dedicated to sustainability and climate efforts, and that's part of what we're here to talk about today, as you'll notice from our resource tables. I get to be a part of the city's efforts to make our community more sustainable for all of us now, but also for our children, for the next generation of people living in our city. The climate and energy and environment are one issue, I think of a few special ones in our city that are urgent right now, because if we're not thinking about them and addressing them, 20 years down the line, we will have really failed those who come after us. So I thank you for being here today. One of the central components of our efforts at the City of Columbus is the Green Spot Program. The program seeks to educate and inspire households and businesses to be green and to recognize those that adopt sustainable practices. One thing I love about the Green Spot Program is that it puts sustainability within reach of everyone, from the great businesses that you just saw to my own household. And everyday residents, large organizations, large property owners, and again, everyday residents can access what it means to be sustainable and to do their part in creating a more sustainable environment through the Green Spot program. By the end of 2016, Green Spot exceeded 15,000 members throughout the city of Columbus, and we are always pushing to continue to grow and increase that number. Green Spot offers unique opportunities for, again, all people of all sizes, businesses, residents, households, to get green. David Celebrezzi will be going over those opportunities in greater detail during our climate education session, which is a part of this program that I'm excited about. And of course, one of the primary ways that Green Spot recognizes sustainable practices is through today's awards, Green Spotlight Awards. Very catchy title. I don't know who thought of that back in the day, but I love it. So I'm happy to help recognize these companies for their sustainability work and the example they set for others to follow. So as you can see, we have a number of honorable mentions that deserve recognition. And I think, or is there a video or is just the list up here? Just the list, awesome. So, and now I'm pleased to announce the 2017 Outstanding Members. So these are the folks that deserve honorable mention. I can't actually see them, so I can't read them out to you, but you all can see them, I hope. So take a minute to appreciate those. And then I am pleased to announce the 2017 Outstanding Members with a Green Spotlight Award. The Large Business Award goes to the Ohio History Connection.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Burt Logan, Executive Director and CEO of the Ohio History Connection. And you might think that being in the history business, our mission statement would talk about beginning in the past, looking at the present, and then the future. But we changed that mission statement a few years back to really embrace the present before we look to the past and then try to impact the future. And I can think of no better way to demonstrate that we're living that mission statement then through the Green Spotlight Award, and it's the team behind me. You know, this is one of those moments when, as the executive director, I just get to stand here and say something. These are the people that have done the work, and other colleagues at the organization. But we really do take our responsibility for the environment seriously. Our building was built in 1970, so it's approaching 50 years. And to be able to achieve a lot of the things that we have in a building of that age is a real tribute to the ingenuity, the creativity, and the dedicated effort of our team. So on behalf of our team and our full staff, we certainly accept and appreciate this award, and we'll continue to move in the same direction, and we'll shape the future as we embrace the present. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. The Medium Business Award goes to Dawes Arboretum.
I'm Peter Lau. I'm with the Dawes Arboretum. We're very honored to receive this award. One of the things that the Dawes Arboretum is known for is plants, trees and shrubs. But we go deeper than that. We go down to our soil. We go down to the landscape as a whole. We look at everything from the construction materials we're bringing in, how we develop the landscapes, the wildlife, the pollinators, the insects, everything really does make the landscape a whole. And it's not just the plants and the animals that we are dealing with, it's the people. We really want to connect with our community, our neighbors, and really grow as a organization to support the sustainable methods. It's the designs of the landscapes that we're putting in, the bioswales, the rain gardens, the erosion control methods that we're using with native plant material, locally grown native plant material that supports every aspect of our environment. And if you're interested in what kind of plants to plant in the landscape, come see us at the Dawes Arboretum. We'd be happy to share that message with you as well. Thank you.
Your outfit is on theme too. Your shirt, I like it. How'd you rival that on St. Patrick's Day? Okay, a lot of green. And the Small Business Award goes to Serenet. And there's all kinds of additional information about how these businesses went green on the awardee highlight document. Their accomplishments are leading the way in sustainability and truly are worthy of recognition. I appreciate all of you being here today and being in this cause every day. So thank you and congratulations. Next, I'd like to recognize the 7 organizations that are graduating today from the Green Spot Sustainability Initiative class. These businesses have attended a 6-session course that spanned 6 months. Together, these businesses represent thousands of employees who have shown a dedication to sustainability. They are, and please come up when I announce your name, they are Columbus Fair Auto Auction. Come on up. Hot Chicken Takeover. And Hot Chicken Takeover is expanding, right? Hours now open 7 days a week, starting next Monday. All right, so Mondays, new lunch spot. IGS Energy. Are they here? Kaufman Development. Yeah. Thank you. Matt Frey Stadium and the Columbus Crew. Nestle Quality Assurance Center. I'm sorry, Nestle. I do like that pronunciation. And then I know that the next one is not here, but we want to make sure we mention them, Olentangy Paddle. Congratulations to all the graduates, and again, thank you for being a part of the program. So now I have the privilege of kicking off the second half of today's agenda. It's our climate education session. This is an opportunity to highlight the inspiration behind today's awards. Not only are we showcasing the outstanding work of local businesses, but we are also emphasizing the local efforts that can make a difference on a global scale. We all have a part to play, from our local communities to the state government, to the federal government, to the international community. And we need to urge that all levels of government play a part in combating climate change and making our Earth more sustainable. But as we do that, we cannot forget the part of the pie that we are responsible for. I hope that the example set by our award winners and graduates will inspire other businesses and individuals to make sustainability a priority. And why is it in our best interest to make sustainability a priority? Well, our first presenter can help answer that question. Please help me welcome Jason Cervenick, who works at the Bird Polar and Climate Research Center at Ohio State. Jason will be presenting an overview of local impacts from climate change that we are already seeing in Central Ohio, what we can expect in the future, and the climate action plan that is currently in place. Welcome, Jason.
Great to see everybody this morning, and thanks for having me. The nice thing is with today's event, the center that I represent at Ohio State does work on six different continents to understand our climate system. But at not every event am I able to then point people to a lot of resources in order to look at actions you can take, from energy audits to getting involved with a lot of the organizations here. So after I'm done speaking or the program's done today, I encourage you to go ahead and explore some of those options at the tables today. Who here has been on a tour of our facility? So a few people in the room. I would encourage you to do so. The Bird Center is the oldest interdisciplinary research center at Ohio State. We represent researchers in at least three different departments. This varies from time to time across campus that are trying to understand the climate system. And we do that by looking at things from ice cores, ocean sediment, modeling of the Earth's climate system using supercomputers, and a host of other resources using satellite platforms. I was asked today by David to give an overview of the city work with our climate action plan, work that's been done over the last year and a half to understand what climate impacts we'll see on Columbus and what steps we're taking in order to make sure that plan is well developed, has a lot of technical expertise, and has a public comment period. So the plan that we're following right now began actually 3 years ago, where we did a risk and vulnerability assessment looking at the climate impacts on Columbus. And that document was produced, and there's a number of handouts I have today that I would encourage you to take a postcard with you. This postcard allows you to download all of the visuals that I have today and a summary of that report and the conclusions we've been able to draw of the risks that Columbus will see. Over the next year, we'll be continuing a prioritization process and an identification of actions that the city can take. And our charge was to create a list of actions that are well developed, well explored, look at the range of actions that can be taken, but also provide a ceiling of what the city can do with current resources and also aspirational goals of additional investment, what can be done. I would also like to thank the people that are serving on our task force. They're all listed at the bottom. Some are at the Bird Center, others are with the City of Columbus. Through our risk and vulnerability assessment that was done, this is a summary of the impacts we have already seen on Columbus. So these are not changes to come, but already impacts that have already occurred. So Columbus has already seen a 2.3 degree temperature rise. This is above the US and the national average. So we're kind of ahead of things in that regard. A longer frost-free season, I think this spring is a good example of that. We're seeing much, much longer growing season, but we're seeing things like fall springs where we get an earlier spring that happens followed by a frost. So if anybody has a magnolia tree in your yard, this wasn't a great year for magnolia trees. Our teams have been watching things like wheat across the state to see what the impacts are for wheat as you have frost coming after you had a very, very early spring. We also have already seen an early precipitation or an increase in precipitation, almost 20% in the region. This is predominantly focused in the fall, but it's already begun to happen. And the last impact we've already seen is a heavy increase in these torrential downpours. So if you've been wondering, if you've been experiencing these or had a basement backup or been in an event that was flooded and you're surprised by the intensity of the rainfall that's occurring, that is true. We've seen an uptick in that arena. In fact, the increase we've seen in this part of the country is only topped by what we've seen in the New England area. A few examples and takeouts that have really things that we'll have to focus on as we go ahead and do this action plan, things that stand out in Columbus that maybe are high risks that we need to address, is the urban heat island. So if anybody's familiar with the urban heat island, typically in cities we see a warming, substantially warmer than what you see in outlying areas. We currently know that Columbus has the greatest increase in the urban heat island of any city in the country right now. And in some cases, the difference in temperature between the outlying areas and the city can be over 20 degrees on given days. The impact of this is the difficulty of people cooling their houses, especially those of our most vulnerable populations. It will be less easy in the future to go ahead and cool your house off at night without air conditioning. The next one is these torrential downpours and the resulting in flooding. So this is a picture that was taken from the Dayton area on the freeway. This is an interstate that's never flooded. This happened 2 years ago. This is a millennial level event that occurred, but we expect to see more of these in the future. This does in fact impact both public infrastructure and also private infrastructure. So understanding what we're doing for planning in the city is important, but also what individuals can do and what companies can do to make sure they're prepared for flooding, aren't building in floodplains, and have appropriate continuity planning for their business. The last one is algal blooms that I would imagine if our committee had started doing our work 5 years ago would not have shown up on people's list of most biggest concerns. My parents live in the Toledo area, so when the algal issue happened up there 2 years ago, they had no water for 3 days. And we've already seen City of Columbus invest about $3 million in additional treatment just for taste of water. But this is something that's on the radar as an impact. It is a combination of washing off of nutrients, manure, sewage from cities, septic systems into waterways, but also exacerbated by warm temperatures that allow those the algae to grow and to produce that toxin. So climate change is actually hitting us with a kind of a 1-2 punch here. Projected changes in Columbus, things we can expect to see over the longer term. So the first one we'll look at is temperature. This is the expected number of days over 90 degrees that we'll see in the future. We do expect an uptick in that arena. So individuals that are working outdoors, this is a concern. Making sure that infrastructure is able to handle this higher temperature load. Also, the average temperature will be going up as well. These projections are based on the high emission scenarios, what we expect to see if we didn't cut our emissions and continued on at a pretty high level. This is the current business as usual standard, though. We are not reducing our emissions as much as we thought we would, so we are at this level or above this level. We expect parts of Columbus will see a 4 degree or more temperature increase by mid to end of century. So we are going to see a significant increase from where we are. The other is precipitation. We're expecting more rainfall, probably 10 to 20% more. We're also expecting an increase in certain parts of the year. This will probably be the fall. So what does this mean for individuals that are harvesting crops? What does this mean for people that are working the fields and have to try to bring equipment out there to harvest stuff and you want crops to dry before you go ahead and bring it in? Also, those heavy precipitation events will increase. Events that are over 1.25 inches over the course of 24 hours typically cause damage to infrastructure, basement backups, damage to freeways, scouring, things like that. We do expect to see an increase in those. So, you know, appropriate planning in this arena. I know I tell many people that myself, when I renovated our house, there's actions I took to make sure that I had a rain garden in, I made sure I was shedding water from the house appropriately and able to plan for these, but many of the people I was working with doing that work, rehabbing the house, weren't aware of some of the information and why I was making some of the decisions I was making that were modest investments, but I knew would pay dividends in the future. In summary, This is what we can expect from the future by mid-century. So this is a graphic depicting what Columbus's climate will look like by mid-century and end of century. This gives you a better sense, a kind of a gestalt of what the feel will be in Columbus, that our winters will look more like what you see in Virginia, North Carolina. Our summers will look more like what you see in Arkansas. This graphic is probably not accurate. Our current forecasts show that our summers will look more like what you see in northern Texas. So actions to mitigate climate change are terribly important. There's actions we can do to reduce our emissions now in order to avert some of this. At the same time, the committee work that I'm doing with the Green Team largely focuses on adaptation, making sure that that change that we know we are committed to at this point, we are appropriately prepared for, and appropriately prepared for the people that can least are least able to pay for the damage that's going to be done. Because in many ways, they have not caused the problem, but they will have to live with the impacts and making sure that they are able to afford a good quality of life and care for themselves. For those that are interested in some of the details on, this is the summary of future impacts too. So these are all the impacts we expect to see over the long term. Probably less snow in the winter, more freezing rain, precipitation increases, additional longer growing season, and as I mentioned, 3 to 5 degree temperature increase by mid-century. There's a graphic I have in the back. If you'd like to see the list of all the impacts, this might inform your business practice, might inform how you operate at home. If you work for government office, it should play a role. Our team will be creating this action list. And that action list, we hope, can be like many of the cities around the US, provide a framework for people to better understand what can be done. These are three examples from Chicago, Minneapolis, and San Francisco. You can see the ranges of when these different communities started addressing climate change and what their action plans look like. We've seen some like San Francisco that's not a centralized document alone any longer. It has pieces that are immersed in the various departments of the city so that they have agenda items they're doing to respond to climate change in both the mitigation and adaptation front. Others like Columbus are new on the scene, but we also have a very robust look at our impacts and vulnerabilities. Many cities don't. We're also finding a lot of the big urban areas in Ohio are very interested in working together on this because there's no state agency work. So a lot of the urban areas and the work we're doing in Toledo, Cleveland, Cincinnati is helping guide the rest of the state. A good example of this is MORPC's document with Sustaining Scioto that was done to look at our water resources in the city. That document was used to look at the modeling data of climate impacts as the state and ODOT did their resiliency report that they recently produced. I mentioned the importance of this and actions we take because there is an additional option besides mitigation, adaptation, and that is suffering. Our teams do work throughout the world, but climate change that is not appropriately mitigated or adapted to will result in suffering of humans. People that are most vulnerable in the population, and it's important to consider that that is the third option and that no action on this is a decision and that it can adversely affect people's lives. So with that, I would encourage you to get involved. There's many resources here today. The economics are very consistent today with good environmental practice and good environmental stewardship. We live in a time of great opportunities. And for those who would like to learn more, feel free to email us, get a hold of us, tour our facility. We'd be happy to share more with you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jason. And one fact that I want to make sure I get right that you told me several months back, this 5 degree potential increase by mid-century, to put that into context, how much colder was the average temperature during the Ice Age?
We right now are looking at going up half the amount that we went down to get to the last Ice Age that would have put a half a mile of ice over Columbus. So we drop an amount that will go up half that amount. I always tell other people that the better way to think about this is if anybody's household is like mine, and I change the temperature a degree or two, my wife knows before I ever show her the thermostat. We all think of 1 or 2 degrees and how valuable and much it impacts us. It's the same way.
Yeah, absolutely. That's pretty astounding to put it in the context of the Ice Age when we were half a mile. We would have been half a mile down in ice sitting where we are right now. So thank you, Jason. When I hear Jason talk, when I see those numbers, I'm reminded something I think we all know, that climate change is one of the human rights issues of our generation, and we have an obligation to pay attention and to help. So thank you, Jason. And with that in mind, I do want to emphasize that local efforts make a difference, that they're part of the pie, and we should feel that responsibility to take part. So it's an exciting time for the city of Columbus when it comes to conservation and sustainability. Many of you have heard about possibly the Smart City Grant, Smart Columbus, that was recently awarded to us last year by the U.S. Department of Transportation. The grant focuses largely on innovative transportation solutions such as automated cars, rapid bus lines, and other methods of efficient travel, and also focuses on electrifying our fleet and creating more electric vehicles opportunities for our average consumers. Additionally, for years now, the city has coordinated with local businesses, nonprofits, community groups, and residents to form a green team, which the amazing Catherine Gervis chairs, and I know you've heard from her today. This team works with the city to identify and implement projects to reduce local impacts on the environment. So to do all the things that we need to keep our eye on and aggressively pursue. The city has many green initiatives currently, and we know that we still need to do more and more. But what we do now includes Branch Out Columbus, which set the goal of planting 300,000 new trees by 2020. When people hear, sort of when your average person hears about efforts to add tree canopy, we think of it as beautification, which it is, and we think about how we make our neighborhoods more physically appealing and livable, but tree planting is also a social justice issue. You look at areas of cities across our nation that are underplanted, you know, that have reduced tree canopy, and they are, and I see our Dawes Arboretum folks nodding over here, the importance of trees and plantings in city environments helps to keep temperature down. Heat islands occur because some neighborhoods really suffer from, and that's that human suffering piece, suffer from lack of trees, which contributes to air quality and health issues. So we're really excited about these Branch Out Columbus goals. We also have the PACE program, which provides an innovative way for building owners to finance energy efficiency and sustainability upgrades for their building. And it's basically a tool that's added to property taxes. We authorize this through the City of Columbus, and it's a financing opportunity. So really large businesses or really large property owners like the PNC Plaza high-rise downtown, they were able to use this financing opportunity, which it's hard to get loans for energy efficiency upgrades that are competitive from banks. They were able to use this financing through their property taxes to pay for upgrades that allowed them to reduce energy costs by 15%. In a large energy user like a high rise, that's a really big deal. We also have the Green Columbus Fund, which is a grant program that uses financial incentives to encourage sustainable development and redevelopment. We have our curbside recycling program, which has made a lot of news headlines lately. And you know, we have a lot of work to do to make sure that we're providing quality and frequent services for our citizens and also doing it in a cost-efficient way. SWACO is here, and they are a part of all those conversations, and they know intimately the value of recycling when we look at long-term resources for the city, like our landfill. It has real cost if we choose not to recycle as a city in terms of public infrastructure. Our landfill is a plot of land, and when we run out of it, that's a community-wide issue. While making the recycling program as cost-effective as possible is an ongoing effort, it's very important that the city's efforts to be green, that we continue to support those and give, again, our residents the ability to access that recycling. One of the city's most grassroots initiatives, as I said, is our Green Spot program, and we love that program and excited about it. The Green Spot program is a way to highlight the collective impact that individuals can make. So I want to welcome our next presenter, David Celebrezze, who will talk more about the Green Spot program and how you can get involved. It is the topic du jour, and David does an excellent job with our program. So come on up.
Thank you, Councilmember. No pressure, right? No pressure. So I appreciate everybody coming out, taking the time out of your day to spend it with us here, and appreciate the accomplishments that our award winners and those who are being recognized today. And we heard from Councilmember Brown about a lot of the really cool activities that are going on at the city to address social issues and climate change. And we heard from Jason what climate is already doing and what it could possibly do here in the future. And I know that can be very overwhelming because by its very definition, climate change is a global issue. However, there are a lot of things that you can do right now, even before you leave this room. We do have a couple things here, such as AEP Ohio's their energy efficiency program. How many people here are familiar with that program or have taken advantage of that program? Awesome. It's the right crowd. Well, if you haven't taken advantage of it, please see Mike, who's over there at the table, and you can get more information about that. That's not only great for the environment, those reductions, but it's great for your wallet. There's also Columbia Gas of Ohio. They have an energy efficiency program as well. How many people have taken advantage of that program here? So a good number of people too. Well, if you haven't, again, before you leave here, please see their table over there and you could sign up right now, and that's taking that next step to be green. So I do see a lot of friendly faces, a lot of familiar faces out here. And sometimes at events they say worlds collide, but I don't think that's right for this. I think more of the stars are in a line is more appropriate for today. And that's the beauty of sustainability, is that we all want to be more sustainable as individuals, as households, as families, as businesses, and as governments. And we really do need each other in order to accomplish that. So one of the three main tenets of GreenSpot is to inspire. And I hope by the end of today you'll feel inspired to continue your green progression and to continue, maybe take the next step, maybe get some neighbors involved and things like that. Especially after you hear what the award or what you've heard the award winners accomplish. The second tenet is really to educate. And we do that through our program where members choose different actions to conserve and protect water, conserve energy, and reduce waste. And you can see on the monitor some of those pledges that are available. I know it's kind of hard to read. Some may seem obvious, like installing a rain barrel, or changing out light bulbs, or recycling, or buying an electric vehicle. Other commitments may be not as much so, at least initially. For instance, visiting a city or metro park at least three times a month. Not only does that have tremendous health benefits, both physical and mental, but it lets us know that these places are important to the community. And the third tenet of GreenSpot is to recognize. And we do that by giving every member, how many people here are GreenSpot members? All right, I think this is the only event where just about everybody raised their hand. If only one person raised their hand, I might have to second guess my job, what I'm doing. But so you received a decal when you joined GreenSpot decal for your home. You also received a letter from Mayor Ginther welcoming you to the program. And there are many other ways in which we recognize our organizational members and our household members. And today, collectively, I'd like to share some of the successes our collective successes our household members have had, as well as our business members. So you can see on the monitor, I think it's on the right slide here, that our members, household members, have changed out over 2,500 incandescent light bulbs to CFLs and LEDs. Nearly 1,000 have pledged to purchase Energy Star rated appliances. 3,600 pledged to plant a tree, which that fits nicely into what Councilmember Brown was talking about with the Branch Out Columbus initiative. We've had 6,500 pledged to install at least one rain barrel. And we have three folks that have pledged to purchase an electric vehicle. Now I know what you're thinking, Dave, 2,500, 1,000, 3,600, 6,500, three. Why are you highlighting the three folks that purchased the electric vehicle when you have all the 15,000 members? And the answer to that is sustainability is a progression. So there's always something that we could be doing or that we should do that's a little bit greener. And it's always looking out for that next thing. And that really is the great thing about GreenSpot, is if you're new to sustainability, you want to get green and you just don't know where to start, it provides a framework to do so. There's easy things on there like turning off the water when you brush your teeth. And I know that kind of sounds really simple and makes sense. But you'll save several gallons a day. And if you multiply yourself by 15,000 people, that is significant savings. Maybe it's changing out your light bulbs at home. But maybe you're that seasoned environmentalist that's been around for decades and you're like, I'm doing everything that I can. Maybe there's something in Green Spot where you haven't thought of. So maybe it's insulating your home to the Department of Energy's recommended R values. But let's translate all this into actual environmental savings. So you can see on the monitor the millions and millions of tons of CO2 reductions and gallons of water that have been saved. And I know these slides are text heavy. They say, Dave, don't put a lot of text on slides, you'll bore them. And I say, you know what? I'm gonna put them in green circles since it's the green spotlight. So you can see there in that pretty image, but I know it's still kind of hard to grasp. So our household members, they've saved enough water in last year to fill 49 and a half Olympic swimming pools. And how much CO2 in terms of pounds reduced? Well, that's enough for 22 blue whales. And as you know, the blue whale is the largest creature that has ever lived. Now, again, I could hear you saying, well, why? There's no blue whales in Ohio. I don't think there's ever been blue whales in Ohio. But there are cardinals. How many people here have seen the red cardinal, our state bird? Everybody, right? So how many cardinals, in terms of pounds, do you think it equates to? 68.8 million cardinals, or just, oops, like, oh, I didn't include it. I had a big picture of a cardinal I was going to show you. Oh, well, I led you right to the edge of the joke, and then it fell flat. But, and these are numbers just from what folks are reporting. So, let's go back to the blue whales. So this is a little bit from our business members. So they've saved over 15 million gallons of water, 28 million pounds of materials been recycled or reused, and $7 million has been saved. So not only is this good for the planet and good for our community, it's good for your wallet too. And we look to increase these numbers significantly by next year, but we need your help to do it. So everybody who's a member of Green Spot has their own personal dashboard. So basically a way to think about it is you have your own spot on the Green Spot website where you can track what you're doing to be green. So maybe once a week, once a month, go in there and log your activities, and then next year, hopefully these numbers will be a lot bigger. I do want to highlight some of the other Green Spot programs that we have out there going on. We're teaming up with the arts community to encourage artists to use reusable and recycled material in their artworks. If there's an energy component that they're using renewable energy sources, and then we're willing to highlight that through Green Spot. We also have the Green Spot Kids program. How many people are familiar with the Green Spot Kids program? Even if you don't have kids, it's okay to raise your hand. It's an excellent book. It's made for second graders, and we have some copies over on the table you can pick up on your way out. So that program, we've merged it with the Green Spot website, and we have over 45 Green Spot and non-Green Spot activities for educators. And not to put Councilmember Brown on the spot, but she did an excellent recording of a reading of the book that's going to be available to, that will be available on our website, but it's also going to be available to elementary school teachers in Columbus City Schools. And then we have kind of another fun program called I Green Spot Because I Love To. How many people saw or have done that or have heard about that? So we have a number of people. So this is a way to really kind of create more buzz around Green Spot and just a fun way to get recognized for what you're doing to be green. So maybe it's you like to compost, maybe you like to recycle, maybe you like to install rain barrel. So before you leave today at the registration table, where Cheryl is over there, thank you Cheryl, she's waving her hand. You could write, we have one of those there, a dry erase marker. You could write what you like to do. We'll take your picture, I know, and then we'll put it up on Facebook, so no stress. Now I could hear, if you don't want your face up on our social media page, you could do what one of our members did, and they like to plant trees. And so they just held the sign up in front of a tree and took a picture that way. That works too. We also have our Green Spot Community Backyards program that we've teamed up with Franklin Soil and Water Conservation District, which offers rebates on rain barrels, compost bins, native trees, and native plants. And then we have our Green Spot website, which all y'all should be familiar with that, but this is the personalized dashboard I was talking about. We are going to have a section on there by the end of the year that's going to have those numbers I talked about, the amount that's been saved in terms of water saved and CO2 reduction in recycling, because it is important, you know, to get recognized for your actions and to know that your actions are feeding up into something larger than yourself. So there are a lot of, we also have, I left this off my notes, but we have Green Spot Neighborhoods. So We work with neighborhoods to bring them together to develop a sustainability plan for, basically it's a 3-year plan, and each year we plan out the next year. We have a couple of green spot neighborhoods right now, and we're looking to add at least one more by the end of the year. I can't tell you who is who's thinking about it, but I'll keep you in suspense, so you'll have to come back next year to hear who they are. And then finally, there are a lot of events that are coming up this Earth, you know, they say Earth Day. I kind of say Earth Month. It's really Earth Season, Earth Year, right? So there's always a lot of things that are going on. I encourage you to take advantage of some of those. And finally, I do want to give a shout out to my team at Department of Public Utilities for all that they do to support me and support GreenSpot. I also want to shout out to our Green Team Community Engagement Working Group. With them, my job is fun, enjoyable, and I feel like I'm making an impact because I have that support. And ultimately, it's you all who make up GreenSpot, right? You all are the members. You all are the ones who are tracking what you're doing to be green and getting recognized. So I just want to thank you all for that. And just remember, you know, it does take one, you know, one person, one business, one community group to set the example and to make the difference. Thank you.
So we've heard some great stories today about how businesses and individuals can make a difference. Remember, no matter what is happening in the world, we get to control our response to it. And choosing to live more sustainably and choosing to explore is not something you have to do. It's something you get to do. It's something that helps connect you to your values, helps connect you to your community, and helps create the world that we all want. So please check out the tables in the expo. See what you get to do next. See what really inspires you and moves you. Talk to the people around you. Make these efforts viral and help people see that this is about making our lives better and being together. So thank you all for coming. We will see you next year at the 10th Annual Green Spots Award. Go forth and prosper.